Bonjour tout le monde, willkommen bei Tintincast. I am Marcus Wilson, and this, dear viewers, is the wonderful Miles Watts, my brother from another mother and father.
It's true, it took quite a lot of people to create the two of us. But you don't have to think too hard on that.
And welcome, you're very welcome to episode 32. Well, episode 23 of Tintincast.
By episode 32, I wonder what we'll be on. Probably the sequel to the Spielberg film, which will finally have been made.
Oh, fingers crossed.
Yeah.
And so when we started this podcast during the pandemic, Miles, my brother had passed away, so Miles very kindly suggested that we read through all of the Tintin books again, which we did as children at primary school together, really to take my mind off things. And, you know, 2 years later nearly, we have around 25,000 views and counting. We've made plenty of friends along the way, and we've had some great contributions to the channel, so thank you for that. Do read the chat in the comments in the YouTube channel, because there's some really interesting submissions there. And we've had some wonderful things sent to us as well, including this wall chart by friend of the show, Tom Hiskey, Miles.
Yeah, Tom, bless him. He's a guy that we know from York. And he's absolutely lovely. And he just sent us this graphic and said, I hope you don't mind I've done this graphic. And I was like, what do you mean, I hope I don't mind? And also Jake Rundle, who did the fantastic cartoons of both me and Marcus. Just, it's so nice that when artistic people are inspired by something and then share it with you and say, look, I've made this, you know, it's really, really sweet. And yeah, it's just added so much to this, to doing the series, knowing that people are watching along and
it has. What are we calling this? We're calling this a wall chart, a ballometer, or what's...
Yeah, a ballometer just sounds really inappropriate, I think.
So this is all the scores that we've awarded the various Tintin books over the series so far.
Yeah, and if you go to the playlists on this channel, you can see what Marcus's and my favorite books are. And there's a slight difference. There's a couple of crossovers, but there are slight differences. That's Edgar in the background doing his best Snowy impression.
Good, good. We always like Edgar on the show as well. Yeah. And since we last had an episode, I've been very fortunate to go to Porto and discover the incredible Tintin shop in Porto, which is called Tintin Por Tintin. Tam Tam Por Tam Tam.
Yeah. Sure. Also, when were you there?
I was there in June, and then I was there again in October.
Well, I just got your postcard today.
Oh, lovely.
So, probably from October.
That was only like six weeks. So,
I know, that's pretty good Portuguese post there. Very good.
So it's a wonderful shop. If you ever go to Porto, I strongly recommend actually make a trip there just to go to this shop. The gentleman who runs it doesn't have very good English. My Portuguese is pretty bad as well. So we were trying to communicate with each other. I think I got him to understand that we were recording a series of podcasts about Tintin. Yes. I think that then I explained that to his son and daughter as well. So hopefully he knew that. So go along. It has some incredible first editions of things. They keep all of the first produced Tintin strips, cartoon strips from the original Portuguese translation. I think the children's magazines, the Papagaio, I think it is in Portugal, was one of the first, or the first color Tintin magazine supplement outside of France and Belgium.
That's amazing. It's a real treasure trove, isn't it? I mean, the photos you took made me incredibly envious. I wished I was there. And it just looks like this absolute Disney world of Tintin. Well, there's an idea. Let's have Tintin world. That's what I want to know. Why are there not a Tintin world? And also, why are there not more games? Because, you know, Marcus and I are both big fans of tabletop games. And we've either played or gifted or, played these games between us but over the years. But I wish there was a Tintin one, because I think it would sell really well.
Yeah,
it'd probably be a globe-trotting sort of game that started off on one side at Marlin Spike Hall and then went off around the world. But I would love that with collectibles and stuff. Maybe one day.
I like the idea.
Yeah.
But today we're not talking about games. Today we are talking about films, and specifically the 1960s live action Tintin films. And this is reasonably appropriate because apparently Hergé said once upon a time that when he drew the Tintin books, he wasn't actually drawing cartoons. He was filming movies on paper. I love that.
I like that. And I remember the first experience I had of these films was at Harrogate Grammar, where we used to go as little boys. And in the library, they had a copy of Tintin and the Golden Fleece. Because I remember you booked it out, I booked it out, we brought it up to class and stuff, and it was odd because it was the first live action pictures I'd seen of the Tintin characters, and it was really strange. We were like, oh, this looks weird. Like, I remember thinking from the off this looked weird because it wasn't the comic. And it's interesting Hergé should say that, because I obviously love movies, but I'm not one of those people that thinks movies are sort of like the ultimate art form. I love the Tintin books because they are comic books. I think that's, and as I've said, the animated series are a lot of fun, but the books are just the absolute sort of zenith of Tintin, I think. You can't get better than the Tintin books.
Yeah.
So I was always a bit sort of snooty about this, until I obviously saw it in later years.
But the film wasn't really available to us, was it, back in the day, back in the 80s when we were growing up? And no. Methuen seems to have published two book versions of the films in the late 1960s, but it isn't really, certainly in the UK, it wasn't until the BFI re-released the films around 2010 that there's actually been decent, cleaned up English language versions of these available. And they do look and sound great.
They did. I thought Golden Fleece looked much better than Blue Oranges, but it might be the copies we were looking at.
Yes,
I think we
were watching a particularly dodgy copy of the.
I think we were the transfer we watched for Golden Fleece was from a Blu-ray, whereas the other one was from a crappy DVD, I think, or perhaps even video recording.
Yeah, possibly.
But yeah, interesting films. So my initial thought was, why are these people dressed up? When we had the picture book at school, which was actually just a photo book, they didn't do a cartoon of it. It was a photo book with story, and it just had stills of the actors playing your brother George Wilson, who played played Haddock. And I just I remember thinking at the time, this looks very odd because these characters, they look like they're from a play about Tintin rather than My Tintin, which was obviously the cartoon.
Yes, I mean, Captain Haddock does look rather like a member of the Village People in the film.
He does. He looks a bit or like a Marx brother with a sort of painted on the beard, you know. And I think until the Spielberg Jackson film, I should stop calling it the Spielberg film because it was directed by Peter Jackson, not Spielberg. I think until that, I hadn't seen a moving version of Tintin that I loved. And that includes the cartoons, where I think we'll come to that movie one day because we want to review it. We both love it. And Andy Serkis did such a magnificent job as Captain Haddock. And this guy was great, I think, George Wilson, and also the guy playing Tintin. I think they're very good. They're well cast, let's put it
that
way.
Well, this is the first of the films. So this is Tintin and the Golden Fleece that was released in France first on the 6th of December, 1961. Because the films, although Hergé was involved in both films and they share similar writers, the only real other consistent thing between the two films is Jean-Pierre Talbot, who plays Tintin in both films. And he, we won't go into the background of the making of these films so much because we covered that in the previous episodes of Tintincast. Yeah. But Jean-Pierre Talbot, who played Tintin, was essentially a teacher and I think a physical education instructor. And he was really picked to be Tintin because of his physical resemblance to Tintin. And he was introduced to Hergé and the two seemed to have become friends immediately. And Talbot did know the Tintin books. He was a big fan. So he jumped at the chance to play the boy reporter. But he also said that when Hergé first saw him, Hergé said, yeah, that's him, that's Tintin. And apparently that gave Jean-Pierre Talbot the confidence, because he wasn't an actor, obviously. He didn't want to disappoint the audience. So that sort of gave him the permission almost to be Tintin. And the film actually became quite a big success in France and Belgium at the time. And apparently he still gets fan mail to this day.
Oh, bless him. And he's still, he's still going. And was he only really in these films then? He was only in these two films?
Yeah, after these two films, he went back and became a teacher again.
It's very good because, first of all, you know, how do you embody this character in live action? Same with Haddock. How do you do it? And I think that's one aspect they did very well, because I think Golden Fleece is the superior film of the two. I don't know if you agree with
that. By far, I think, yeah.
I think by the time they did Blue Oranges, it was a little bit, okay, let's do another Tintin movie. And it's a little bit scrappy in places, but it's got that fun, zany energy and some quite nice cinematography and some nice performances. And I think, yeah, the cast actually acquit themselves pretty well to capturing the tone of the stories, I think.
I think George Wilson, particularly as Haddock in The Golden Fleece, just has got embodies Haddock really well. Although he looks like this village people character, he does kind of veer wildly from this romantic, sort of poetic drunk to like massively angry and sort of just goes between those two things in the film, and that works really well, I think.
Yeah, he does portray Haddock really well, and just the way he moves, and even though he's having these little moments of reverie where he's dancing and imagining things, and it's very in character. Actually, I was picturing the comic while he was performing. I was thinking, yeah, that's Haddock, that's exactly what I would do. He's very quick to temper. I think generally he really does well in this performance. And as I say, until Andy Serkis kind of nailed it in the Jackson one.
Yeah. The locations are beautiful. I mean, we should say that it's filmed, I think, in Greece and Turkey mainly, is where the action takes place. And the shots are all framed beautifully, you know, as every shot looks like it could be a frame straight out of the Tintin book. I think it's just captured in this film, particularly less so in the Blue Oranges.
Yeah, that's one of the things I thought was really good about the films. It was like a kind of a tourist video. It was so beautiful. And they'd made a very good choice in having very sunny locations, nice wide shots with nice moving camera. I thought actually the cinematography was really good and very pretty.
The guy who did the cinematographer was Raymond Pierre Lemoyne. I can't pronounce that. But he apparently was a cinematographer for Black Orpheus in 1959, which is actually also a beautiful looking film.
I mean, it's clearly a professional guy doing, not that they'd hire a professional, but you know, and it's clearly a seasoned cinematographer.
Yeah, it is sort of picture postcard from Greece and Turkey, but also Marlin Spike looks beautiful as well. That's the Chateau de Villette in Paris-Condescourt, in the northwest of Paris.
I love the Marlin Spike scenes, actually. I love the fact that, again, it felt like the book. It felt like we join Haddock and he's in his hammock, Haddock in a hammock, and he gets disturbed. And then later on, he's back in Marlin Spike. It's kind of like he just wants to relax. I mean, you would if you owned that place.
Yeah, there's a beautiful first scene of the postman kind of trundling up on his bike, which is actually very reminiscent of Andrei Tarkovsky's The Sacrifice. But that's probably the where the similarities end between this and Tarkovsky's films. But
that's a very highbrow reference.
Yes,
there,
yes, sorry.
I mean, I'm not saying I haven't seen Tarkovsky's films, but that one I haven't seen.
The music's great as well.
Yes, the music's great. It's just a really good production. The production is great. It feels rich. It feels like Tintin. The colours are they pop. And like you say, it is like those. It reminded me of some of the sort of, you know, Crab with the Golden Claws and King Arthur's Sceptre, where you have these great big full page splash pages where you've got, you know, the location and you see these beautiful arches and stone buildings and the cameras. But having it like the camera moves in as well. It did feel very Tintin. So I think they sort of did the right thing, which is to make it not cartoonish.
Yes, exactly.
Reminiscent of the comic books.
Yeah,
you know?
It's a proper film. It's not trying to be a cartoon strip. It is a proper cartoon. And a lot, as you say, I think a lot of the set pieces in the book where it's not the original story, it's you can see things that are borrowed from, you know, Crab with the Golden Claws, Unicorn, Red Rackham, and I mean, things like the cannonball they throw down the spiral staircase when the baddies are chasing them. I mean, that's straight from the Black Island.
Black Island, yeah. That's what I loved about it, though. We talked about this in previous episodes where we're talking about the books, and, you know, we've gone on to some of the later books, Tintin and the Picaros, and especially The Lake of Sharks, which we did, the last one we did. They start to do a sort of best of Tintin, which is let's get this character in doing that. Let's get Cuthbert Calculus in being eccentric. Let's get the Thompsons in being clumsy. And of course, it's going to have a little bit of that in a film version, because this is the first film version. So, but I think generally they did pretty well. Like, the thugs are good, you know, the thugs feel like they're straight out of the, but again, it felt like Black Island. That I think they cast it well. They wanted obviously to look it to look like a Tintin story, not just a live action movie with a bunch of people. And so it does have that sort of elements of cartoonish. And I thought the most cartoonish looking character was Calculus, actually.
Yeah, Calculus, when he's blowing up the outhouse at the start in Marlin's Spike, and
the red smoke coming out. Yeah, it's great.
Yeah, and I mean, Nestor's there, but he doesn't seem to be there to do much apart from top up the captain's whiskey. Yeah. That's all he does.
Yeah,
but also Tataragua, is it the South American location where they basically that there's
Tataragua,
been this coup and a revolution and thing, and it's all tied in with this story of the fleece that is the boat that's left to Captain Haddock. Now, Tataragua could be like San Theodorus or Nuevo Rico from the other adventure stories. That
I expected to see one of their sort of despot friends, Rastapopoulos, or one of the enemies or friends from a previous book and everything. It felt very much like a roundup of some of the best bits. Like, it was, if you're going to do a live action Tintin movie, have all these elements in it, which they do. You know what I mean?
And also, I mean, Hergé was a consultant on the story and the script, so obviously he's overseeing this stuff. And there's even, he's drawn the end credits, and you see the characters sort of in cartoon form, you know, how it might have looked if it was a proper cartoon book as well, which is really interesting.
Yeah, that was really good. There's something else they did well in the Peter Jackson movie, which again, well, I should stop talking about, really. I'm going to talk about that
next time. But the one thing that I thought was really interesting, though, is that there is a bit in the film that actually preempts something that would only happen later in the comic books, which is the Marlin Spike brass band turn up at the end of the film. They don't actually come into the comic book series until the Cast of Fury Emerald, which was released 2 years later. So it's sort of almost like the film influenced that next book.
That's true, actually. That's interesting. I wonder if Hergé was sort of bashing ideas around with the filmmakers and went, by the way, I'm doing this for the next book, so stick that in. Because he did have a hand in it, didn't he? He sort of was... He was involved in the movie. Yeah. I mean, he was interested in it, but I think by that point he was slowing down considerably. But I can imagine him going, oh, yeah, get a scene in there, because I'm just and the director going, all right, yeah. It's got that fun ending where they're all looking in the sky and the music's going off and the car drives off and you've got that big... So it just kind of has that feeling of a French farce, almost like maybe Jacques Tati or something like that. It's almost got... Or just a bit of sort of Jean de Fleuret, or just, it's got that sort of... class with a bit of slapstick in it, but it's the way it's shot and the way it's acted, it just feels like a nice 60s French movie. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, I mean, the locations that they have are absolutely beautiful. Obviously, they don't have a massive budget, so they can't do too much in the way of certainly no CGI back in the day, but Tintin or Jean-Pierre Talbot being a physical education instructor and knowing, I don't know, judo or karate or one of those, he does all the fight scenes himself and actually looks quite a psychopath in some of them. I mean, some of the fight scenes he's like pretty serious about. Yeah,
I know that again, they embodied the characters really well, and I thought that mentioned for the Thompson. They're brothers, aren't they, in real life? I think they're called Pedro and Pablo.
So the Golden Fleece, they are credited as Incognito, the actors playing Thompson and Thompson. But it's Pedro Gamonal and Pablo Gamonal. Yeah,
there
absolutely.
That's it. That's right. This first one, isn't it? And I know Snowy as well is credited as Milou, which is the original French name Milou, isn't it?
Yeah.
What was his name in Belgian?
I think Milou, but I could
same.
Be wrong.
Yeah,
I think so.
I always, because I know, having watched a lot of Poirot, I know someone's always going, no, it's not French, it's Belgian. It's like, okay, there's a difference, I know. So I always think, what are the differences between the Belgian Tintin and the French versions of Tintin? Is it a huge difference in some of the names and stuff? I don't know. But I thought the actors playing the Thompsons were very good. I mean, they did that sort of falling off the boat thing, and they do that very well. With the legs in the air again. I thought the physicality was very good, and so was the guy playing Haddock. I thought he was just very good at the physicality. They've obviously studied the figures of the characters in the book and how they, because there's a very specific way that the Thompsons move and that Haddock moves, to show that obviously Hergé wanted to show exaggerated things like his legs going up, his arms going up and stuff like that. And they seem to emulate that as if they are not quite human beings.
Yes.
You know? Yeah, totally. So I thought they fell into the sea very well, the Thompsons.
Yes, 10 out of 10.
Yes.
The other great thing I think about the Golden Fleece is the plot, because it's actually quite an intricate plot, given that it's really, you know, for kids and, you know, for kids.
You know, for kids.
And so there's this thing about Haddock inherits this Golden Fleece boat. He finds it. It's a bit of a rust bucket. But there are people trying to get their hands on it. And, you know, they're being offered vast amounts of money if he hands over the boat. So obviously Tintin and Haddock get suspicious. So they think, well, maybe we won't. We'll just fulfill some of the deceased's last requests and go to Greece and do some tasks, and then decide if we'll sell this thing on.
Yeah.
And then gradually you start to see these other kind of characters. There are kind of ship hands that are hired who look like they're suspicious. There's this talk of a revolution in South America, Tataragua, and money going missing, gold going missing. Potentially, then there's this old photo with various Papadinik, isn't it?
Yeah, that's right. There were loads of new names in this to learn, weren't there? So I was like, they were flashing past. Usually in the book, you can learn the names as they go. But I was okay, I've got to learn all these characters' names.
So it turns out that Papadinik and these five associates, there was some kind of revolution in South America and they stole all of the gold and it disappeared somewhere, and maybe Papadinik has it, but where is it? There's a treasure map. There's where is this gold located?
Yeah. And
it's a really interesting and quite detailed plot line that plays out through the movie, and you don't know which of the associates is, you know, on the side of good, if there are people kind of in on the boat who might be kind of good guys or bad guys in this.
Yeah. I love the fact that the victim, the kidnapped guy, is called Scooby Doovich as well. I'm sure that was a reference to Scooby Doo.
Yeah, totally.
Scooby Doovich.
But one really, really interesting thing is, and this was pointed out by Aria in Iran, who's a friend of show and gets in touch with us. He said that when we watch this film, we should check out the 1963 film Charade, because some of the plot points are very similar.
Yes.
So I did watch Charade straight after this one.
Of course.
And there are lots of parallels. I mean, Audrey Hepburn finds out about her late husband's secret life with five shady associates from a series of photographs.
Yeah.
She's told that her husband stole a lot of gold from the US government.
Yeah.
And that these four former associates are after it. Basically, Audrey Hepburn is playing a similar role to Captain Haddock in the film.
Right.
I mean, it's kind of a weird thing to say, but
no, I know what you mean. She goes back to her husband's house, which has been emptied, and the people are after. Yeah, you're right.
Yeah, she gets threats from former associates, Paranik's associates in the case of Haddock. So the themes are really similar. Who can you trust? Who's telling the truth? Who are the good guys? Who are the bad guys? And in both stories, the treasure is hiding in plain sight under the noses of the protagonist. I won't say what it is in Charade, because
if you haven't seen Charade, you've really got to watch it, because it's like you spend the whole movie going, how is this gonna, but it's really funny too, Charade. I think it's a great comedy.
There's loads of parallels. So I got Aria quite rightly pointed this out, so I got really interested and I thought, right, did the writer of Charade take inspiration from the Golden Fleece? And
there is a connection. Was it Frantic? And no, what was it? Frantic.
We talked previously about the connection between the Calculus Affair and Roman Polanski's Frantic. So this is my second. In fact, it's Aria's. It's not mine. But so Charade was written by Peter Stone. And so I started doing a bit of digging on Peter Stone, and Stone graduated from Bard College in New York at the end of the 1950s, I think, 40s, 50s. Anyway, his mother eloped to Paris with a Hungarian literary agent named Georges Martin. And after visiting them in the late 1940s, Peter Stone lived in and around Paris then for about 13 years. And this was, of course, the glory years of Hergé when all the best books were announced, like the, from the Moon Adventures through to the Castafiore Emerald.
Yeah.
And the release of the Golden Fleece was at that time. So he was likely still in Paris when Golden Fleece was released in 1961. It was a really popular film. Tintin was massive at the time. Mm. It's really likely that, that a guy living in Paris spoke the language. He's a writer. He would have likely gone to the cinema and seen that film. He even used the pseudonym Pierre Martin. So there's this really strong French connection. So I think that Peter Stone took inspiration from this film.
I think you might be right.
Charade the following year, because it was then accepted in 1963 in Hollywood.
And I know coincidences do happen, but also artists do steal. So, you know, he might have thought it was cool and decided to do a, I mean, Charade I wouldn't exactly call a serious film. It's very much a sort of parody of Hitchcock, really, even though it's in its own right, it is a great film, Charade.
And parts of Charade is set in Paris, you know, and there's that connection with Frantic, of course, because that's also, there's scenes set in very similar places.
It's like 6 degrees of Frantic.
Yeah. Yeah. So thank you to Aria for pointing that out. We think we might have hit upon something there.
I think there's definitely something in that. Yeah, I mean, actually, it's funny. I'd forgotten that you'd said something you'd mentioned Charade via text the other day, and I'd forgotten you'd said that. And then when I was watching Golden Fleece, I didn't think of Charade, but I should have done, because Charade's one of those films I've probably seen about 50 times. I love it. But you're right. There's lots of similarities, and the villains of pure Hergé, really, aren't they? In Charade, they could be. There's a guy with the claw.
Yeah.
You know, there's the guy. There's the scene of the funeral of the husband where they all turn up to make sure he's dead, you know, which is joyful. And he sticks a pin in his head and holds a mirror up to his, just make sure he's breathing.
It was great watching that again. But yeah, the similarities. Yeah. There seem to be too many similarities for it to be a coincidence. Yeah.
I think you're right. We should try and get any of the original filmmakers on the phone and say, now.
Yeah,
look.
Absolutely. If anyone knows any more about this, get in touch.
We'll follow it up. Yeah.
So we should go on to Tintin and the Blue Oranges in 1964.
Yes. Which is kind of I suppose the Blue Oranges is kind of, now we've talked about how much everything we love about the Golden Fleece, probably diminishing returns for Blue Oranges.
Yeah, sadly.
Yeah. It's an interesting plot because it's got something to do with science and calculus and that kind of thing, and calculus trying to do good, and this weird, you know, it reminded me of The Shooting Star, where you're like, why are there giant things appearing all over the planet? The planet's dying. It's like, okay, why are these blue? Why are these oranges blue? That's the sort of mystery of the title. Why are the oranges blue? Why do they light up?
Yeah. And there is a kind of connection to the calculus affair in that there is this invention, which is blue oranges that can grow in the tundra, in the frozen tundra and in the desert. In this case, it's not calculus who invents it. It's a colleague, Professor Zalamir,
in
Spain.
Right. Yes.
But they both get kidnapped, just as in the calculus affair.
Yeah, they do. It was very calculus affair, actually. And again, I thought even more than Golden Fleece, they'd got elements from all these other bingo. Right, let's put that in. Like I said, mentioned earlier, they put Castafiore in, which is really nice when they arrive at the Opera House and there's a poster, and it's a Hergé poster of Castafiore, which is really nice. You're like, oh, that's really nice touch. And there she is with a prosthetic nose and horrible screeching voice, and you know, Haddock gets dressed up, and so there's lots of fun to be had. I think they wanted to do something slightly different with the second film. It's got more calculus in it as well. Calculus just sort of pops into the first one, so it has elements in it, but I think it just falls a little bit, it falls short for 90 minutes.
Yeah, I mean, the plot isn't as rigorous and intricate as the Golden Fleece. It feels almost like an hour and a half of chase scene. It's like watching Benny Hill for an hour and a half or something.
Yeah, I was a bit Benny Hill.
The pacing doesn't really change. And there's sort of things throughout. I mean, there's this nice thing where Haddock is sort of shadow fighting on a staircase when he finds that the sword.
That's really nice. Yeah,
which is really nice, but it's kind of not really integral to the plot. It's not. It's sort of out of unicorn or something, or red rackham, and it's not
That's
really.
right. I think it's out of one of those, isn't it? Yeah, when he's imagined himself fighting with a cutlass. And I think, again, the Thompsons are in this one a bit more, and they do some good, you know, they're in the hotel, they have some good slapstick, they have some good farce and that kind of thing. So
There's a
that.
lovely thing actually with the Thompson twins when they're in neighboring rooms, and it's done as this sort of split screen thing with the two detectives mirroring each other's actions, and then the baddies turn the tables on them by getting dressed as the Thompson twins, where it's usually the Thompson twins getting dressed as other people.
Yeah, that was
And
nice actually. The split screen was very, very nice. I thought it was very funny. I thought, oh, this is clever. And that was about halfway through, wasn't
yeah,
it?
and they were twins, I think, the Thompsons in this film as well. It's no,
Right.
sorry, they weren't. No, apologies.
No, I think they were in the last one, weren't they?
No, it says here they were identical twins who provided. So it was
Oh, okay.
the and Andre Marie and Pedro Sanchez. So there were
Yeah.
ex-wrestlers apparently and twins.
Well, they're very good. The physicality is very good.
I think it was Pedro's only film, but Andre had a long track record in Belgian and French film, apparently. But they were really
Yeah.
good in it, I thought.
They were really good. They get to have a car crash and they get all these little very Thompson-y moments. So I think that's what sells the second film for me. I think the novelty had worn off a bit by the time I'd watched Golden Fleece. I thought Golden Fleece, well, that was nice. Good acting. And so, and then the second one, it's like, okay. The novelty of it being a live action has worn off a little bit, so it needed more to happen, a bit more density to it. So it was fun, and it was, and it ticked by.
I think
But
there's a whole kind of cast of sort of younger, well, I guess kind of just kids in this particular film, which I can understand why they'd want to throw that into a Tintin family film, but it kind of, for me, it made the film less professional,
yeah.
and
Sort of,
it.
it sort of pauses to have this sort of scenes of reverie with people, and it just felt a bit, it goes documentary style, and the style goes off a bit, doesn't it?
Yeah, and it does try and start to use these more cartoony tropes. So at the start of certain scenes, it'll sort of have the, meanwhile in somewhere in Spain, and then it'll
Yes.
have, and that kind of didn't work for me. It wasn't used consistently enough or
No.
frequently enough, and it didn't work. So, and the
Yeah.
framing wasn't as tight as Golden Fleece.
No, it wasn't. Maybe not as much effort was put into it or money spent on it or something, but it was just, yeah, it wasn't quite as good. So but it was nice to see another one, because I didn't know until recently that there were two, you know. I think last year we discovered that, or I discovered the blue oranges.
Well, there was
So
supposed to be three. There was supposed to be another film after this in 1967, but it never came to anything. And the idea was that the action would have taken place. It would have been the same actor as Tintin, but the action would have been set in India. And I quite like the idea of a
Oh, that would have
Bollywood
been good.
Tintin film.
That would have been really good. It would have been very colourful. I mean, they're both very, very colourful films. I thought there's some really nice costume designs, some really nice extras everywhere, and nicely framed shots. There were a few shots in the first one that I think would rival David Lean. They were just really
Yeah,
nicely
totally.
organised and framed and just staged and everything. And so I thought there's a lot to recommend it. But you sort of, if we were going to give, are we going to give them any crystal balls, these films?
Well, yes, let's give him balls. What would you?
Okay. I'd give, out of seven crystal balls, I'd give Golden Fleece, maybe I'm going to give it a five, because I mean, I was quite happy while I was watching it, and I was chuckling along and I was enjoying it. I'd probably give Blue Oranges a three, which is a bit stingy.
That's weird. I've got exactly that written down here.
Okay.
Five and three.
Yeah, because I'd recommend, like, if you're a fan of Tintin and you love the books and you just love Tintin, watch the Golden Fleece if you can get a Blu-ray copy. It's really fun. It's a good effort. The second one is like a B-side where you're like, okay, well, that's
But
another one.
the Thompsons do end up in the Marlin Spike Fountain at the
They
end
do.
of the second. And I was trying to remember for the life of me, I can't remember if I felt like that happened in a Tintin book elsewhere, but I can't remember which, and maybe I'm just thinking of an Inspector Clouseau
Yeah, we were
film
talking about
instead.
that
I
the
don't
other day,
know.
weren't we? Yeah, maybe. I think those are fair scores, really. I think, I thought I would be reading, you know, the book at school, and then it would be something that one day I would see. But it's taken me 40 years to get around to seeing this film, so I can't have been that keen on seeing it, because I thought it probably looked a bit odd. But to me, it felt like, because I know we've talked about in previous episodes where they actually did a Tintin play that was quite successful. Was it?
Yes.
Was it Cast of Fury, or it was one that was, we were saying Cast of Fury could have been a good Tintin play if you went to see it at the theatre.
Yeah, I think it was based around the Black Island, actually, the play.
That's right. That's right. I remember now. It's been so long since we did that episode. So I thought it was going to be... So there were elements of this is a Tintin movie and it's not the book. It's not the book. But actually... I found myself not being too bothered that it wasn't the books anymore while halfway through, because I was like, it's done so well, I'm in the world.
You know? I was pleasantly surprised. But if you are going to watch one of them, obviously watch The Golden Fleece.
Watch The Golden Fleece, yeah.
Classy movie.
If you're a completist, go on to Blue Oranges, because it is quite fun. But yeah, I would say if you're going to watch Tintin movies, that's one to watch. But then what's another one to watch, Marcus?
Well, in fact, we'll be back to review The King of Them All next time. We're going to be looking at, finally, there's been a lot of requests for this, Steven Spielberg and Peter Jackson's 2011 film, The Adventures of Tintin.
Bizarre.
So, No, it still doesn't. But we'll see if we can get any information about that before next time. But
good idea. Yes, we'll give Spielberg a call and see if he's working on it.
Absolutely. Well, thank you all for dropping by. It wouldn't be anything without you.
It wouldn't.
So we hope you'll join us next time.
Please do, and thank you for continuing to watch the show. We love you.
See you next time.